Gider.
Hi benim.
Yeah, hi Smart, good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah, how are you doing?
Doing great, sir.
This is yeah, hi Priya.
Yeah, we have Suman. Suman, whenever we're continuing with your interview,
Okay.
right? I'll just start the recording and I'm leaving the call.
Yes, it's normal.
Thanks, Vinay.
Yes.
Thanks, Priya. Suman, this is Vinay here.
Yes.
So, yeah, I have overall like 13 years of experience in IT. So, mainly on to DevOps and AWS. So, I'm working here as an AWS architect. So, the requirement what we are looking is mainly on the cloud and the DevOps. So it can be on any of the area on the DevOps.
Okay.
It can be either infrastructure as a code, implementing the CI/CD pipeline, or implementing the security.
Okay.
Right? It can be on any part of the DevOps implementation because DevOps is very huge.
Huge, yes.
Right? So a single person cannot be expert in all the
All the
areas.
areas of DevOps.
So if the candidate fits in for any of the expert aspects, so we would be happy to onboard the person for that particular role. Hope
Okay.
the expectation is clear.
Yes. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Fine. Can you brief me about yourself?
Okay. Yes. I am Suman. I have 4 years of experience as DevOps engineer. In these 4 years, I mainly worked on DevOps tools like Git and Maven, SonarQube for source code quality management, and Jenkins, Docker and Kubernetes. I have expertise and I have worked on them, and I have little knowledge on Ansible and Terraform, and I have experience in cloud AWS, cloud infra AWS.
Okay, so total, what is your experience?
Total is 4 years. Into DevOps, like 3.5 years.
Okay, fine. So, what is your day-to-day activities? Sorry.
Okay, actually we have like pod systems, so in our pod we are every guy is like will be dealing with the project, single project, one or two projects every day, every guy. So if it is the project is from scratch, I will be implementing will be creating the we'll be installing the Git, and we'll be creating the repositories branches, and we will be giving the access to the developers, and we'll be creating the the CI/CD pipelines, and we'll be creating the CI/CD pipelines with building writing the codes for to get the code from the source code, and we'll be building and we'll be pushing into the Nexus and Nexus or ECR, and we'll be deploying to the if it is a small scale application, we'll be deploying to the Tomcat. If it is a big application, we'll be deploying to the EKS. The recent application which I worked as AWS ATO service, we were deployed into the Kubernetes cluster, EKS underlying Kubernetes cluster. So
Okay, fine. So, have you worked on any of the cloud technologies?
Cloud technology as such, I have experience on AWS only. AWS.
So, what are the services you worked on AWS?
Mainly EC2 instances, basic networking part like VP, creating VPC, CloudForms and ALBs, sorry, ELBs, and auto scaling groups, and Route 53. Basic cloud infra, I have experience, and we have dedicated cloud team and infrastructure, greenfield implementation team. So they have some dedicated full admin full access. We have like only read-only access.
Okay. So have you worked on setting up of the pipeline?
In Jenkins, yes, sir. Worked.
Yeah, the pipelines.
Yes, pipeline and declarative. We have for earlier projects, we have like a free shell projects, but most of the projects we are working on
Okay.
declarative.
Okay. Fine. So what are the stages you have in your pipeline?
We have a build stage. We get the okay. We have like a get the SEM stage, which will get the code from the SEM, and we have the build stage, and we have the after that we have the sonar cube. You know, the it will check the basic sonar. You know, it will check the quality of the source code, and we have like the deploy to the we have the creating the build stage. So it will create the Docker image, Docker image out of the Docker file, Docker build stage, and then we have the push stage, which will push the Docker images to the ECR, and then we have like a deploy stage. We will be deploy the the containers to the EKS infra manager service.
Yeah. So how about unit test?
Unit test, we have like one of the tools like Jacoco. Tool Jacoco tool, we done it. We have done it through Jacoco plugins.
Okay. So, what is the programming language that is used?
Groovy. It's for scripted way. It's,
no. What type of application? It is a Java application.
Yes,
you deploy
yes,
or
yes, yes. Yeah, the application was Java one.
Yeah. So, for Java, what is the unit test that you have used?
We have used Jacoco plugin.
Okay, what does it do,
Jacoco? It's like it does the unit testing, but internally I don't know. The Java developers have them. They're guiding us. Like we'll be creating it, but internal application and internal functionality, I have no idea.
Fine, fine. Okay. So, have you used the Sonar Cube in your pipeline?
Yes, yes, Sonar Cube.
Mm-hmm. So what do you evaluate there in the Sonar Cube?
So, like we have the rules given by the developer team to create the quality profiles. The reused rules, we will be creating a parent rules, and we will be applying in the quality profiles. Mostly it does the vulnerabilities and code smells and bugs. It does the job, and we have like quality gates. Quality gate, what does it do? It does like whether the source code is ready to push the to next environment, like if it is like a the Sonar Cube mainly used in developer in environment only. Like quality gates will let us know like if at all it pass the all the conditions, then then the code will be push the code to the source code from the environment to the staging area.
Mm-hmm. So what do you evaluate in quality gate?
Yeah, like bugs and vulnerabilities, code smells, we do evaluate.
Mm-hmm. So can you just give me one example, like what you have implemented in your project with Sonar Cube?
The quality profiles we have implemented with most of the rules will be given by developers, to be frankly. So we'll be creating the rules already. Parent rules are there, so we just kind of apply the all the rules on the source code.
Okay, fine. After Sonar Cube, next what would be the step?
Once the source code quality is done, then we do the building by using Maven.
Okay.
Then it does the basic the Maven has different life cycles. It does the job like validate the course source code quality structure source code structure, and it does the basic testing, and does it does the compilation of code. If it is a Java application, it build into the jar var err by specifying what we specify in the pom.xml file, and then it will be create the package, and then it will be pushed into the if we apply Maven install, it will be push the code to the .m2 folder, which is locally available. And if at all we give a Maven deploy, it will be push the code to the Nexus or remote repository.
Okay, after that?
After that, we have once we build it, the build code will be deployed to the Nexus Artifactory. Nexus repository. After that, in CI/CD pipeline, we do like a the code will be get from the Nexus, and if it is a small scale application, what we do is like we will be deploying directly the in the earlier application we have used Tomcat, so the we'll be deploying the code to the Tomcat application. We'll be deploying the application to the web apps folder. It does a basic job, and for a small scale application we do some EC2 auto scaling and we do basic EC2 auto scaling. We'll be creating a EMI out of it, AMI out of it, and we have like a auto scaling groups specify. Auto scaling group specify. Then we'll be creating the. For small application, we'll be pushing the code to the web apps folder in Tomcat, and if it is a web, if at all the client wants to it in big scale, and if at all a lot of microservices involved, we'll create a Docker container out of it in the build stage, in Docker build stage by using Docker build -ip the underlying the file name, and we'll be push that build file to the image to the ECR. And then from there we will pushing the code to the EKS so into the managed service of AWS. Managed
service of AWS. So how do you deploy the file to Tomcat?
To Tomcat, like we'll be pushing the code to the web app folder.
How do you do that? How do you push it?
Excuse me. So for some application we'll be pushing the code into the /bin/devops web apps directory. Then it does the job.
How do you push that to Tomcat?
The in declarative way we have the stages. The stage, you know, the Tomcat stage, in Tomcat stage, it will be pushed to the build file to the web, the var file will be pushed to the this one web apps folder.
Okay, fine. Okay, after pushing it to the web app folder, what do you do?
After pushing, for that we need to have some some credentials, like, you know, in Tomcat we have like a some user credentials, manager-gui and the manager-gui and some script-gui, and there are some user credentials are there. So prior to that, only prior to deploying the code, we need to have some administration privileges in Tomcat. After that we will be log into the Tomcat homepage and we will be able to deploy the web apps folder. And after that the okay, in EC2 auto scaling the application, the EC2 auto scaling will be okay, we deploy the Tomcat into the EC2 EC2s. So E2s is, we have number of EC2s, so these in front of this EC2 we have one load balancer. We configure this load balancer endpoint to the route 53, so the endpoint the end traffic will come to the first, it will hit the route 53, which is DNS. So through after DNS the control will be the request will be hit the load balancer. So the route 53 will be give the ELB IP address. ELB in AWS we have ELB IP address. Through ELB IP address we have like access to the EC2 auto scaling groups, a number of EC2s. So in EC2s we have Tomcat lies in. So in Tomcat we have web apps folder. In that web apps folder we have the application. In for small scale applications. In Kubernetes application we have like a same RD. So the Route 53 will be involved. Route 53 will the control the traffic from the end traffic from Route 53 will be moved to the goes to the ELB. The Route 53 will be get the IP address of the ELB. From ELB. From VLB, like we have number of nodes, some kind of EC2s. We have nodes for every node. We have like a in if at all if it is a EKS cluster, we have services. The service will be discovered by the pod. We have pod. The pod contains the applications. So if at all if it is like a Kubernetes application.
Okay. Fine. What is auto scaling group?
Auto scaling group does auto scaling of EC2 instances depending upon the metrics. You know, if at all we give we specify the metrics like CPU utilization is 70%. When the threshold pan hits, it does it calls the next EC2 instance. So depending upon the load.
So when it calls next EC2 instance, what will happen?
So the next EC2 instance will be popped up, and it the EC2 instance has already like a in EC2 auto scaling group we have like a, if at all if it is a EC2 auto scaling, it has already the if at all the EC2 has installed Tomcat and web apps folder, we create a, if at all we create a AMI out of it. The AMI will with the save the configuration of AMI, the EC2 will be popped up, and with the same configuration what we configure in the AMI, with that configuration the next EC2 will be popped up, and it also take the traffic from the ELB.
Then how do you deploy your application to the new EC2 machine? Your new EC2 machine will have only Tomcat, right?
But yes. When we create a AMI out of it, when we create a AMI out of a Tomcat application which has the web app, which has the application, the EC2 instances, the under EC2 instance we have Tomcat, under Tomcat we have web apps folder, in that web apps folder we have application, right? So what we have done is we create a AMI out of this this fully configured EC2 instance.
Okay. So I have deployed a version of one, and you have created an AMI of that, and you are deploying it.
Okay.
After that, I have done several changes to my application.
Okay.
I have done 10 changes to the application.
Okay.
But your AMI will be having your old.
Yes. For that, we need to create a new AMI out of it. For every changes, we need to create a new AMI out of it.
Okay.
In that case.
Fine. Once you create a new AMI, how do you configure the auto scaling? What all components will be part of auto scaling?
So in auto scaling, like we have a target groups. We have health checks. sorry, it is in load balancer ELB, right? Okay. In auto scaling, like we specify like minimum and maximum number of the VMs, the EC2 need to be get popped up when the depending upon the load.
Okay, fine. Then where do you specify like what type of instance you need to configure? How many instance has to be there?
Yes. For that we have launch configuration and launch templates. In that we specify it. Okay. Launch configuration, launch templates are there. In that we specify all the bootstrap script. It will be create internally. It will create a bootstrap script. So in that we specify what kind of VMI and all the details will be specified in the launch template or launch configuration. I missed the point. Sorry.
Okay, fine. Then what happens?
So we have a new AMI we create.
Okay. So what are the different types of auto scaling that is available?
One is launch template, and the new one is launch configuration and launch templates.
No, auto scaling, what are the different scenarios in which you can do auto scaling?
Different scenarios. I'm unable to recall it. I have done it, but I.
When do you do auto scaling? Why do you need auto scaling?
Yes, when we have no idea, like for small applications, like when we have no idea for highly availability and for highly availability purpose, we go for auto scaling. So depending upon the traffic incoming, so when we want to, like the AWS or managed services, like they want to expand the availability, expand the services, the servers of servers and the application highly available for the purpose of highly availability, we go for the auto scaling. So depending upon the load, the servers and applications bandwidth will be increased. So when the traffic is down, also then the infra will be shrink.
Okay, fine. So till how many servers will it increase?
Whatever the maximum number of servers we specify, till that point will increase. Like we have minimum and we have maximum number of instances. So whatever the maximum number of instances we mention, and whatever the load it is coming, so till just with the depending on the load number, load the topic will be the auto scaling does the job. Auto scaling will be happen.
Okay, so what is the load balancing?
So load balance is like so we have number of EC2 instances. Let's say we have three EC2 instances, and which have already the Tomcat, and which have the web application. So in these three Tomcats, so the load balancer does send the traffic to different servers depending upon the algorithm which we serve. So if it is a application server, application load balancer by using a port like ATR 443, by using port based and host based routing, it sends the traffic to the different EC2 instances. So it won't send the traffic to one server.
Fine. Then what are the other services you have worked on? AWS?
VPC.
Okay. So what is VPC?
So VPC is like a virtual private cloud. It has a mini network in the AWS infra. So in that we have public subnets and private subnets. And in front of this VPC, we have an internet gateway which let the internet connect to the VPC, and the private subnets which don't have the the internet connectivity, and public subnets have the internet connectivity. And we have a route tables in which, like the route tables will it does the routing jobs in it. In VPC we can specify the CIDR range like slash 10 dot, like it's the range is from like 16 to 28, like from a range of 16 IPs to from a range of big 65,536 IPs we can specify in single VPC. If at all we want a connection from one VPC to another VPC, through VPC peering also we can achieve this, so that the instances in one VPC will be able to talk to the talk to the other another network EC2 servers.
Okay. Fine. So how many VPCs can you have in a single project?
For single account, we have 5 EC2 instances. Like if at all we have account specifically, we can have, there is a count for elastic load, elastic IPs, we have 5. And for a single account also, we can have, by default, the AWS which provides is, we can have only 5 VPC accounts. If we want more, and we can just give a call to the, otherwise we'll create a case in AWS, and or else we'll talk to the AWS customer care. They will provide the more IPs, more VPC ranges, I mean to say.
Okay. So what is difference between public IP and private IP?
public IP is like a, so public IP anyone can access, and any server from outside can talk to it. And public IP is like a, it is very isolated one, and we kind of we cannot provide access to it. Through only NAT gateway we can provide the access.
Mm-hmm. What is the difference between internet gateway and NAT gateway?
Internet gateway is like it sits before the VPC. It sits before the VPC, and it let the VPC connect to the internet. And NAT gateway is like a subnet level thing. The private subnet will connect to the NAT gateway.
Okay. So what is the route table?
Route table, it does like a, it does the, it routes the traffic to the different IPs. It has some routing algorithm, and we specify like a, so it's
fine. Okay, fine, Suman, I'm done with my discussion.
Okay.
So do you have any questions from your end?
Actually, I did not thought it will be more on AWS infra. Actually, I have expertise, and I work more on Kubernetes and Docker, and more of AWS thing. I mean to say DevOps thing. I don't know. Okay.
Not. So you are good at Docker and Kubernetes, is it?
Yes.
Can we just have another 4 or 5 minutes discussion on that?
Sure.
You don't mind?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Fine. So what are the Docker commands you are aware of?
Yes, to create the... So first we have Docker file. It does some instructions. After that, we create a Docker image out of a Docker file. For that, we have Docker build -t tag. After that, we have like Docker images. It lists all the images, and we have like to create a Docker container out of Docker image. We have Docker run -d in detached mode -p like the host port and the container port and the Docker image name, and which repository, which registry we want to store into it. And Docker PS, it lists all the all the like containers, like Docker PS -AAQ, the state equal to the exited equal to true will list the all the exited containers, so which are not running. And we have like Docker RMI, Docker we can create it.
So in kubectl,
okay, right, yes.
What are the different services that are available in kubectl?
Kubernetes. Kubectl or Kubernetes. Oh, Kubernetes. We have Kubernetes. We have a cluster IP. We have a node port, and we have load balancer. The cluster IP is the service which let the a pod to communicate with from within the cluster only. If at all the service is node IP, then the outside traffic will be able to connect to the pod in the pod the pod level, and we have like load balancer service which will does the load balancing service in the in Kubernetes underlying Kubernetes infra.
Okay, so there how do you scale the pods in Kubernetes?
In Kubernetes we have like a replica set and replica controller and deployment set. In deployment we specify so basically deployment set is the best object to use.
Now for scaling, what should we do?
We have a HPA, horizontal pod autoscaler, and we have some metric server. So metric server will get the all the metrics of the Kubernetes, and it let us the HPA to scale the pods.
Okay, so what should be the on what basis does your pod gets scaled? What do you need to define there?
Yeah, in that we have like limit resources and requests. So every pod need to have this much in limit and resource section we mentioned like CPU and memory. So after that after a node got filled with the pods, the HPA will let the HPA will create a new pod.
Okay, and then
a new pod will come. A pod will communicate to the service. Service will talk to the via node port. It will it will talk to the ELB and so on.
Okay. Okay, fine, that's one.
Okay.
Done with my discussion.
Okay. Thank you, Vinay. Yeah. Thank you for time.
Yeah. Thank you.
You want to satisfy, yeah?
Yeah.